Good afternoon. Welcome to quadjacks.com. I am Marco Valerio. Happy holidays. I got a very special gift today. I'm sitting here with my new friend, Dutch Boyd. Dutch, thank you so much for joining me. A conversation over coffee.
I'm glad to be here, Marco.
Thank you. Thank you. Very good to have you. This has been a good year for you, 2010. Santa brought you a bracelet.
Yeah. I can't say I can complain this year.
There was a Six max, no limit hold'em. Was that what it was?
It was six max limit.
Six max limit hold'em.
The very first time they've done six max limit.
The very first time. Okay. Why weren't they doing it before? They say limit is dead. Is it?
Yeah. Limit is a dead game because no limit is watchable. Limit is not watchable. It's like seven card stud or Raz. It's not interesting to watch. Okay. It's hard to watch. It's slow and it's just like chipping away. It's kind of like watching a marathon and trying to be really excited about a marathon when the guy is, you know, four laps ahead of the guy coming in second place. There was no excitement at the end.
Okay.
And limit is like that. You know, all the pots are small compared to a no limit. You never have one pot that's going to just completely make or break your tournament.
Right.
And that is why you don't see limit poker on ESPN. That's why you don't see Raz on ESPN. You know what, poker's poker. It doesn't matter whether you're playing, you know, deuce to seven triple draw or no limit hold'em. It doesn't matter if you're playing five card stud or five card draw. It's all poker.
Right.
And there's really not that much of a difference between the games, honestly.
Really?
I feel like if somebody is going to be world-class at poker, they're going to be world-class at every form of poker.
Really?
There's not new concepts that you see in one game versus the other.
Mm-hmm. What's even a motivation for entering the WSOP? Some guys just want that bracelet because they want the recognition. Others just want to cash and make money.
Marco, I'm one of those guys who don't really get to choose what they play. I'm one of those guys who are backed. So, it's no secret. I've been playing for sheets and backs since they've been backing players. And how it works is I send them a whole list of tournaments I want to play, the 50K horse and the 25K championship and every 10K, and they turn every one of them down, and they say, okay, here's what you can play. Mm-hmm. And that's what you play.
How's the rest of the poker been going this year or lately? Is it going well?
Yeah, I mean, the World Series has always been well. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think I've ever had a bad World Series.
Yeah.
And maybe one year, I think in 2008, I had a negative World Series.
Okay. What if poker ever wasn't going well? What if for an extended amount of time you started observing? No, I mean like, you know, sort of being like, oh my God, you know, what if for 3 years in a row or something, it was all 2008 all over again?
Marco, it's a good question.
Yeah.
And it's something that every poker player should ask themselves,
right?
Because poker might not always be around.
Right.
In fact, I can assure you it won't always be around.
Really?
Of course.
Dutch Boyd prophecy.
The Dutch Boyd promise. Poker's not always going to be around.
Well, neither is mankind, but what do you mean? Like,
everything comes and goes.
Sure.
Something could easily come in and take poker's place. Or poker could undergo some big drastic change that would change the game fundamentally where people wouldn't play it anymore. I'll give you an example. Backgammon.
Yes.
You don't really see competitive backgammon the way you did back in the 70s and the 80s and even the 90s. The reason is jellyfish and snowy. Do you know what those are, Marco?
Jellyfish and snowy. I can probably make some guesses. Not very educated ones, please.
Jellyfish and snowy came around and they're these computer programs that play backgammon perfectly.
Yeah.
So at that point, the game changed because there was a perfect way to play it.
Right.
As we're talking right now, there is a heads-up machine at the Bellagio, which is playing limit poker with other people, no rake. And there's a lot of these bot programs online right now making money.
Really, bots are making money? Because you hear a lot of discussion, a lot of argument about the bots. Like, do they even work at all?
I don't hear any argument anymore. I think that people were arguing it 5 years ago.
Right.
At this point, I think it's pretty well accepted that there are bots at every low-limit poker game you're going to sit on PokerStars and Full Tilt Poker. And that's something that's drastically changing the game. Mm-hmm. You know, there are all sorts of things I can come up with where poker would undergo a complete shift, where people wouldn't play it anymore. Instead, maybe the future World Series of poker isn't the World Series of poker. Maybe it's the World Series of Halo, you know, or the World Series of Photo Hunt. I hope it's Photo Hunt, because I'm a really good Photo Hunt player.
Really?
Yeah.
Is there a perfect way to play Photo Hunt?
Yeah. The computer's going to be able to beat you and me every time.
Really?
Absolutely.
So artificial intelligence machines are going to... Skynet is going to take over poker. Is that what's going to happen? Like Terminator?
I don't know what's going to happen.
No?
What I do know is that poker's not always going to be around.
Okay.
And so when you say, what are you going to do when poker's not around? I don't know. I don't know the answer to that question.
Right.
When it comes down to it, poker is kind of a pyramid scheme.
Right.
And there is a limit to how many new people and new blood can get in. Because there's a limit to how many people are here in the world.
Right.
You know, at some point, that chain's going to end. And since we have a poker economy that is a negative sum economy, that is, money is being taken out instead of added, you will see poker decline, and it will probably end with a limp.
Money is being taken out of poker, you mean like via rake?
Yes.
You have some strong opinions on rake, don't you?
I do, because it's
against
the rake,
I should say.
It's the rake that makes poker the Ponzi scheme that it is. If you look at the definition of a Ponzi scheme, what it is new investors paying off old investors. And that's basically what you see in poker. You know, the people who are paying for the professional poker players are not other professional poker players. It's these new guys that are coming in.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, they're hoping that they're going to be able to get good enough where they get to be one of the old guys taking new money. You know? So, yeah, it's a little bit of a Ponzi scheme and a pyramid scheme.
So is it doomed because of that? Is there any way to save poker? Because I think I heard you.
There is. I do think there is a way to save poker. And the way to save poker is to make it not be this negative sum game where money is being taken out of the poker economy, but instead turning it into something more like a baseball or a golf type economy where money is being put in by outside non-poker related things. And unless that happens, I don't think poker is going to continue to see the kind of growth it has. And it's frustrating, really. If you look at the World Series of the Rio, there's no reason why in these tournaments, why any of us should be paying any sort of tournament juice, you know? And the World Poker Tour at the Bellagio, this is televised. You know, there's a lot of money being put into this thing by advertisers. There's no reason why if I want to go play a WPT or a WSOP, if I'm playing a $1,500 World Series of Poker event, I shouldn't have to pull out, you know, another $100 in juice. They should be putting money in, at least put in gift bags. You know, at least at the WPT, you see them giving backpacks away. You know, you don't even get a T-shirt at the World Series of Poker.
Right.
You get to a point when you're a professional poker player where you don't put money into the economy anymore. You're just taking it out.
Right.
And you know, every time I take money out of the poker economy, every time I cash out at Full Tilt Poker, and I pay my rent, I'm taking money out of the poker system.
Yeah.
I'm not putting it back in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's going to have to change the whole way that we, the whole economy system is going to have to change. I'm against any sort of rake being taken out. I'm also against any sort of buy-ins being put in. I think that if poker is going to change and thrive in the future, you're going to have to imagine a poker where people aren't losing anymore. Where it is like professional baseball. You don't see any professional baseball players losing. And
they don't lose money. Professional, what do you mean they don't lose?
They don't lose money.
Right.
You don't see any professional baseball player losing his house if he loses a game. He might lose his contract. And anybody who wants to be a professional baseball player, they go to tryouts. You know, they don't have to gamble on it.
Okay.
So I imagine, I think poker could, you know, could be much bigger than it is right now, but only if the fundamental type assumptions that we have about it change.